So let me introduce to you the premise and the players of this video. This is a response video made by the channel The Alternative Hypothesis to an error-filled video produced by a channel called Sean. And Sean is a YouTuber that thinks of himself as something of an expert YouTube historian, a YouTube philosopher, and, of course, a YouTube scientist, among other things. As far as I can tell, his channel was originally dedicated to video games, but has moved on since to response videos as being the mainstay of his channel and videos today. The thing is, while Sean makes response videos claiming to be right in all things, he'll never respond to criticism or errors and the intentional mischaracterization of the subjects of his nitpicking. Put simply, Sean is unable to substantiate his responses when called to do so. The reason for this is that Sean is no friend to truth any more than he's a friend to facts. He will bend truth to suit his agenda, and like every good YouTube scientist, he starts with his conclusions and then works backward. And thus, this response video by The Alternative Hypothesis, a channel that responds to YouTube scientists like Sean and his poor understanding of the subject matter. He has responded previously to the YouTube science of people such as Sargon of Akkad, Thunderfoot, ContraPoints, David Pakman, Jordan Peterson, but is probably best known for his evisceration of the YouTube scientist and high school dropout, Croton T. Prior to the revelation of Kraut and T's doxing server and his other underhanded behavior coming to light, and then his fleeing the internet for a year in shame, the Alternative Hypothesis, along with neuroscientist JF Garapay, utterly humiliated YouTube scientist Kraut T and his YouTube science videos over and over and over again. Mr. Medeker has some very good videos documenting the downfall and humiliation of YouTube scientist Kraut T, along with a full explanation of his doxing servers and what led to his exit from the internet. Links are in the description. And now in this video, the Alternative Hypothesis will go through a number of the errors, falsehoods, mistruths, and convoluted explanations that YouTube scientist Sean will go to drive home his ideological narrative. Links to three other videos presented on the Alt Hypes channel responding to what appears to be intentional errors by Sean for the sake of ideology are in the description.
And from the enraged reaction to the bell curve, a new reader might expect the book to be blatant and unapologetic racist propaganda, a neo-Nazi screed arguing for the supremacy of the high IQ white race and such things as that. I go very easy on the book in like the first half an hour, basically, to bait people into watching it. Like from the first, I'd say at least 15 minutes of the video, you cannot tell whose like side I'm on or what angle I'm coming at it from. It's just, oh, it's very clever. Richard Herrnstein passed away shortly before The Bell Curve was released, but the other author, Charles Murray, has in recent years, among other things, been on an episode of Making Sense with Sam Harris. He's been interviewed on Stefan Molyneux's YouTube channel, had his ideas discussed on the Joe Rogan podcast, and regular viewers of my channel will remember The Bell Curve being cited in a recent Steven Crowder video. That's me listing off Murray's accomplishments there, but I deliberately only list off like really, like you know, bottom of the barrel rubbish internet racist shows he's been on. I act like that's all he's done. That's just me being really shitty without seeming like it, that bit.
I'm sure he felt so clever indulging in his duper's delight there. He does the same regarding with the definition of heritability. So, for real, heritability is simply the proportion of variance in a population or between populations on a specific trait, such as height, weight, strength, or any behavioral trait that is a function of genetic variance in that population or between those populations. It's a very simple concept. It is not slippery at all once you have it properly defined. But let's look at how Sean defines it versus how Charles Murray defines it.
Something that is very highly heritable, we would say, has a heritability of 1. Something that is not heritable at all, we would say, has a heritability of 0. If we say something has a heritability of 0.6, then what we mean there is that 60% of the variance of the trait in a population group will be due to genetic factors. What it does not mean is that 60% of the trait in one individual is due to their genes and 40% due to the environment. Heritability tells us about variance within a group, not the makeup of individuals. It is a population statistic. You cannot meaningfully ask what the heritability of your IQ is.
Now that is a satisfactory definition, as far as it goes. Let's compare this to the definition presented in the bell curve. What we want to know is how much of the variation in IQ in a population, the aggregated differences among the individuals, is due to variations in genetic endowment, and how much is due to variations in environment. If all the population variation in IQ is due to variations in environment, then the heritability is zero. If half is due to environmental variations, it is 0.5. If none is due to environmental variations, it is 1. Heritability, in other words, is a ratio that ranges between 0 and 1 and measures the relative contribution of genes to the variation observed in a trait. Isn't this nice? Both Sean and the bell curve present the correct definition of heritability. But in Sean's video, he doesn't present this definition. What he does present instead is this.
These issues are pathetically misunderstood by Charles Murray. In a CNN interview reported in the New Republic, Murray declared, When we say 60% heritability, it's not 60% of the variation, it is 60% of the IQ in any given person. Later, he repeated that for the average person, 60% of the intelligence comes from heredity, and added that this was true of the human species, missing the point that heritability makes no sense for an individual and that heritability statistics are population relative.
Now, what Sean did here is instead of simply reporting the definition of heritability presented in the bell curve itself in a video supposedly about the bell curve, he reached out to some obscure interview where Charles Murray flubbed an answer on this where he was put on the spot. Something bizarre that's been happening is that Sean's acolytes have been commenting on my previous video, saying that Sean did present the bell curve's definition of heritability, and I was very confused when I saw these comments. So I watched Sean's video again all the way through, wondering if maybe I missed it, because that would be a huge blunder on my part. But no. After multiple rewatchings of the whole video, and rewatching specifically the section where he speaks on heritability, nowhere does he show that the bell curve had the correct definition of heritability. And he implies that the bell curve itself is using a faulty definition of heritability, one that Charles Murray gave in a flubbed interview. And this is dishonest. I've never seen anything like this. I've never seen a fan base that just denies something so baldly like this. Now, before continuing through this, I should preempt that all of the arguments that you think Sean makes throughout the video that are really good, such as lack of genetic G, his more technical but badly technical explanation of Lewontin's garden nonsense, his kind of smooth brain suspicion that normalizing data is a trick, his denial of genetic G. We'll get to all of that. Sean is wrong in detail. Nothing he has said in his video is new. These are all ancient, long refuted arguments that mainstream intelligence research does not consider anymore. And I will show you why he was wrong to the capillary level as the series continues. But for now, what I'm doing is focusing on illustrating that Sean is a generally dishonest person as a means of dissuading viewers from just passively accepting things he says. Another bizarre claim by Sean is that studies on the relation between brain morphology and psychometric intelligence stopped after some point.
So way back in the old days, if we wanted to determine someone's personality traits and abilities, we could measure their skull, calculate the volume of their brain, or simply look at their facial features. Phrenology, however, has fallen out of favour with scientists of late, although it should be noted the technology sector is currently in the process of reinventing it. Now, I won't be going all that deeply into the history of intelligence testing today, so I'll just start off here by saying that researchers eventually, for the most part anyway, stopped measuring people's skulls and started trying to measure what was going on inside them.
This is another bizarre world claim that's simply not true. The research continued all the way up to today. Here's just one paper looking at the relation between human brain volume and psychometric intelligence. This is from 2015, and it looks at papers from 1987 to 2012, and they include 148 studies that meet their study criteria, distilled from 444 candidate papers. This study didn't control for sex in the main table. However, when you have non-clinical populations and you control for sex, the correlations are typically around 0.4 within the United States between brain size and psychometric intelligence within the sexes, which explains about 16% of the general variance in psychometric intelligence, given an 85% heritability of brain size, but also a roughly 90% reliability of the brain size estimates. The heritability of psychometric intelligence just from brain size is going to be about 15%, just from this one item. And in fact, in a paper from 2015, modeling the 3D geometry of the cortical surface with genetic ancestry, researchers can predict your race, or genetic ancestry cluster, whatever term you wish to use for race, just from the shape of your brain. So no, this kind of research never stopped. That's just gaslighting. Gould never refuted anything. The research never stopped because it was never wrong in the first place. Philippe Rushton describes Stephen Jay Gould's behavior regarding the advent of MRI data that confirmed the results of the 19th century skull measurers that Gould talked about in The Mismeasure of Man, saying, quote, "Subsequently, of course, discoveries using magnetic resonance imaging, which creates a three-dimensional image of the living brain, have shown a strong positive correlation, 0.44, between brain size and intelligence. And there is more. The National Collaborative Perinatal Study, as reported by Sarah Broman and her colleagues, showed that head perimeter measured at birth significantly predicts head perimeter at 7 years, and head perimeter at both ages predicts IQ. Recent studies also show that head size and IQ vary with social class. It is now clear that the 19th century pioneers, as he calls them, were right. The first of the MRI studies were published in the late 1980s, early 1990s, in leading mainstream referee journals like Intelligence and the American Journal of Psychiatry. My colleagues and I routinely sent Gould copies and asked him what he thought. He never replied. Now he has chosen to withhold all these data from his readers," referring to Gould not including any of this data in later revisions of Mismeasure of Man. So in response to the data, Gould was mute. He said nothing, he retracted nothing, he conceded nothing, he continued to stand by his accusations in defiance of the facts. In 2011, the University of Penn, which houses Samuel George Morton's skull collection, decided to actually, you know, measure the skulls. In The Mismeasure of Man, Gould accused Morton of fabricating data and gave corrected, quote-unquote, measurements for Morton's skulls. Well, it was a very simple task. The team at Penn measured the skulls, and they found that Morton's numbers were correct and that Gould was wrong. An article from USA Today describes it thusly, quote, "Samuel George Morton, in the hands of Stephen Jay Gould, has served for 30 years as a textbook example of scientific misconduct. The Morton case was used by Gould as the main support for his contention that unconscious or dimly perceived finagling is probably endemic in science, since scientists are human beings rooted in cultural context, not automatons directed toward external truth. This view has since achieved substantial popularity in science studies. But our results falsify Gould's hypothesis that Morton manipulated his data to conform with his a priori views. The data on cranial capacity gathered by Morton are generally reliable, and he reported them fully. Overall, we find that Morton's initial reputation as the objectivist of his era was well deserved. None of this matters to Sean. He either doesn't care, or he didn't bother to know about any of this." Throughout the video, Sean used negative reviews from other academics and media and a kind of mixed social proof and authoritative appeal to try to create a vague, general impression that the big claims of the bell curve are radically out of the mainstream.
This is the main rhetorical trick of the bell curve. They pretend to concede to mainstream scientific opinion, but then propose a set of conservative and eugenicist political policies as if they hadn't. At the time of the book's release, the backlash against it in certain sections of the media and scientific community was furious. Dozens of articles were written by scientists and journalists attacking the book, studies were conducted to debunk its claims, whole books were written to debunk its claims, actually, and these criticisms were often phrased very harshly. Columnist Bob Herbert, writing for the New York Times, described the book as a scabrous piece of racial pornography masquerading as serious scholarship. "Mr. Murray can protest all he wants," wrote Herbert. "His book is just a genteel way of calling someone the N-word." This controversy ignited by the bell curve has also had quite the lasting impact. When Charles Murray is invited to speak at college campuses, for instance, people turn out in protest, often with angry cries of racist, eugenicist, and so on.
It would be irresponsible to play Sean's game, should he play it, if he tries to retort with, "But I never said that." This is clearly the impression you are attempting to convey throughout the video, so this impression needs to be refuted because it is a false impression. At least among intelligence experts, the median estimate for the heritability of intelligence is around 50%, with a mean of 49%, according to a 2020 paper on the topic. A 2013 paper by the same authors found a mean response of 47% and a median response again at 50%. From Snyderman and Roth in 1987, we see a result, but the 1987 results actually have a greater proportion of researchers claiming that it's all environment as a proportion of those who gave an answer, because 41% of the population from the Snyderman and Roth sample said that there was insufficient data or they did not respond to this question. From Friedrich's 1973, we have the proportion of intelligence researchers who agree or disagree with the following statement by Arthur Jensen. Quote, "It is a not unreasonable hypothesis that genetic factors are strongly implicated in the average black-white intelligence difference. The preponderance of the evidence is, in my opinion, less consistent with a strictly environmental hypothesis than with a genetic hypothesis." And on that, the majority disagreed or tended to disagree. From Sherwood and Natopsky, 1968, they found a result that surprised me, which was that older researchers tended to favor environmental over genetic explanations generally, not just for race gaps, but for general variation. So when they try to pump up media sources or claim that recognizing divergent evolution in humans in the brain is some fringe position, don't fall for it. It's an attempt at a sort of impressionistic shock when the field is in reality far more divided than perhaps even they know, likely even they know. Moreover, the 60% heritability estimate used throughout the bell curve, this is closer to modern mainstream opinion than Sean's 0% position. 0% or close to it being Sean's position on the black-white IQ gap and racial gaps generally. This is not something Sean explicitly said, but it is implicit throughout the video. And keep in mind, Sean has no problem arguing against implicit positions.
Anyone who genuinely believed all the moderate, hedging quotes that Herrnstein and Murray put in the bell curve would not be able to propose the policies that they do. So the critics of the bell curve see these policies and start arguing against the opinions that they assume Herrnstein and Murray would therefore have to hold. I'm guilty myself of several times arguing against the point that Herrnstein and Murray should have made instead of the one that they did make. Only a minute ago I said the bell curve does not prove that genetics are the primary reason for differences in intelligence, to which the defense is, of course, that they never set out to do such a thing. But they should have. If you don't prove that, then the rest of the argument doesn't work.
Okay, if you want to play this game, when I say Sean believes the black-white IQ gap is 0%, a function of genetic variance, I'm arguing against the position he would have to hold in order for him to take such offense at Murray's rather moderate 60% estimate. This is also something that is done regarding test bias. He presents this as if the bell curve has some radical fringe view on test bias, throwing up some arguments he doesn't impact or follow up on later in the video. In part 3 of my video series responding to Sean, I go into more detail, pointing out how psychometric intelligence tests actually overpredict for blacks and Hispanics relative to non-Hispanic whites across multiple domains, how test questions subjectively rated to be more culturally biased have smaller race gaps than those imagined by a panel of judges to be culturally neutral, and how the rank order difficulty of questions are almost identical. However, intelligence researchers really don't buy into the test bias claims anymore, as it has been comprehensively refuted. We can look at a 2008 survey of intelligence researchers and see that they overwhelmingly do not believe in this test bias myth. And the more they specialize on intelligence research, the less likely they are to believe in test bias. And Sean actually provides an illustrative example of the process by which test bias claims tend to go through.
As an example here, I'm going to assume that we all agree it would be unfair to expect a random teenager to, by themselves, during a test, invent trigonometry. If you include trigonometry questions on your intelligence test, what you'll be testing for there will not solely be the intelligence of the respondent, but also whether or not they've been taught trigonometry before, how recently they were taught it, and how well they were taught it. This is relevant for us here because the Armed Forces Qualifying Test, which is the primary source of intelligence test data in the bell curve, had as one of its four sections a mathematics test which included questions examining knowledge of classroom trigonometry and algebra.
So, Sean rags on the AFQT, the Armed Forces Qualifying Test, for being theoretically biased against black people because it has trigonometry questions. And I say theoretically biased, or that's his hypothesis, because he hasn't shown this. He hasn't shown that trigonometry is specifically biased against black people relative to whites, and then from there show that the AFQT overall is racially biased. Now, the AFQT is just four subtests from the ASVAB, the Armed Services Vocational Aptitude Battery. So I looked into the National Longitudinal Survey of Youth Scores for 1979, that the bell curve is based on, and I actually found the racial gaps for ASVAB takers in 1979. And what we can see is that the scores do vary by subtest, or the gaps do. And I looked up some practice tests online, and the trigonometry portion is in the mathematics knowledge section. Sean simply didn't do the necessary Google searches needed to see that what he was saying was probably wrong. Now, it is possible that despite doing better on mathematics knowledge overall relative to how they do on other tests, that the black test takers were particularly bad at trigonometry, but other kinds of math knowledge, they were less bad. And that if you removed the trigonometry section from the mathematics knowledge section, that the racial gap would be even smaller on this already smallest racial gap section. But really, the way you look at test bias in an objective scientific way is you look at what is the test trying to predict, and you compare that to how well it predicts for each group. And we know that overall, the AFQT overpredicts black performance. The AFQT on the whole package is overall biased against whites. Or at least it was when this analysis was done. If the test is biased against a group, you expect that group to do better at the task than they do on the test made to predict the task. Because say there is a test on hunting and camping skills, and it is given to European trappers and also to Cherokee, and the questions on the test are written by some European who studied the way trappers survive in the wilderness. And the questions are about the European behaviors to survive in the wilderness. The Cherokee would do poorly on that test. However, once you get out into the field, the Cherokee are going to do much better than Europeans who scored as low as the Cherokee on that test. Meaning that test would not predict very well for Cherokee. That test would be biased against Cherokee methods of surviving in the wilderness. That would be an example of test bias against the Cherokee. The AFQT overall underpredicts white performance, overpredicts black performance. That is how we can say in an objective way that it is biased against whites. Now, I don't think this is a very big deal. It's not radically biased, but it is just so fitting that Sean brought this up, this test in particular, as an example of racial bias, and the mathematics knowledge subsection in particular as an example of racial bias on a test, without so much as bothering to check if any of this is true. And it is this not even bothering to check, not even bothering to do basic Google searches, that is a kind of willful ignorance and is a kind of dishonesty. Throughout the video, Sean brings up the Flynn effect and repeatedly states that the bell curve doesn't know how to adequately deal with the Flynn effect, which is the general rise in nominal IQ scores over time.
Addressing the Flynn effect, Herrnstein and Murray write the following. There is a further question to answer. Does a 15-point IQ difference between grandparents and their grandchildren mean that the grandchildren are 15 points smarter? Some experts do not believe that the rise is wholly, perhaps not even partly, a rise in intelligence, but in the narrower skills involved in intelligence test-taking per se.
One thing that Sean doesn't mention is that the term Flynn effect was coined in the bell curve itself. This is something he may or may not have known, but again, if he didn't know this, this is willful ignorance. If he did know this, then he's being deliberately dishonest by not telling the audience this fact, when he spends somewhere around 20 minutes talking about the Flynn effect directly or tangentially throughout the video. When talking about the Flynn effect, Sean is talking about the race gap because that's what this is about. That's what this whole video is about. I'm not going to pretend to be stupid and pretend it's about anything else. He's saying environmental improvements over time raised nominal IQ within the US and anywhere else this happened. So why couldn't environmental conditions narrowing between the races narrow the IQ gaps between the races or any other demographic group where there is an IQ gap? James Flynn himself has a quote that nicely sums up this issue. Quote, the magnitude of the white-black IQ differences on Wechsler subtests at any given time is correlated with the G loadings of the subtests. The magnitude of IQ gains over time on subtests is not usually so correlated. The causes of the two phenomena are not the same. But it goes further than this. Sean claims there's no evidence of falling general intelligence or a negative Flynn effect. And he says this because a book from the 1990s claiming to debunk the bell curve said that there was no decline anywhere in general psychometric intelligence.
Herrnstein and Murray's dysgenics hypothesis is discussed in Intelligence, Genes, and Success, Scientists Respond to the Bell Curve, a 1997 book which responds to many of the points made in the bell curve. The authors of that book, for their part, find no direct empirical evidence either for or against a dysgenic effect acting upon cognitive ability, stating that, insofar as we are aware, there is nothing but anecdotal evidence for dysgenics. So this, if it were true, would mean that people are actually getting less intelligent, but at the same time, they are getting better at taking IQ tests. Now, you might say, isn't that a huge contradiction? Aren't they basically admitting that IQ tests measure something other than inborn intelligence? After all, if IQ tests supposedly measure native cognitive ability accurately, how could scores be going up while cognitive ability is going down? However, to be fair to Herrnstein and Murray, it would be hasty to dismiss their dysgenics hypothesis outright. There is another possibility here, and it's that people are getting genetically less intelligent, but the environmental factors affecting intelligence have undergone such large changes that their positive effects upon IQ are more than accounting for the downward genetic ability shift. So roughly, we would have lost a genetic IQ point thanks to dysgenics, but gained two back thanks to a better environment. So what evidence does the bell curve produce in support of this downward trend in genetic cognitive ability? Well, unfortunately for Herrnstein and Murray, their main source of data, the National Longitudinal Survey of Youth, is not much use here.
Again, this is an example where simple Google searches would give more information. The recent decline in psychometric intelligence, most well known in countries that collect good data on this, in Scandinavia and Northern Europe, is not a fact that is debated. There is, however, debate about cause. So here's a paper I found from Simple Google Searches, something any of you could do, entitled Flynn Effect and Its Reversal Are Both Environmentally Caused. And here's another one entitled The Negative Flynn Effect, a Systematic Literature Review. So the fact that nominal IQs are now beginning to decline, as hereditarians, including Charles Murray, predicted would happen, this is not in dispute. There is argument about cause, and I predict there will be arguments about cause until the end of time, simply because for ideological reasons, nobody wants to admit to idiocracy via genetic decline. What we can say for sure is that this is something hereditarians predicted would happen, while the environmental theorists as a group did not. Moreover, the decline in psychometric intelligence are on the more G-loaded and the more heritable subtests of IQ, whereas the gains previously were on less G-loaded and less heritable subtests. And that is simply a brute fact. So for Sean to just flippantly hand wave this issue away is again either a kind of overt dishonesty if he knows about what's really going on with the negative Flynn effect, or it is a kind of willful ignorance and a dishonesty of confidence, dishonestly presenting that he has good reason to know that this isn't happening when in fact it is. In some areas, Sean's dishonesty is bald and breathtaking, such as his cherry-picking a live interview of Charles Murray to convey to the viewer that the bell curve doesn't understand heritability, or just claiming that brain size research stopped or that Stephen Jay Gould refuted anything. In others, it's more a matter of him not knowing this thing in a situation where he really needs to know about this thing if he's going to talk about it. When you claim the AFQT is racist because it has trigonometry, maybe check to see if, first, if the overall test is predictively biased in the way you claim it is, and check to see if the specific subtest you think is racially biased shows a greater racial gap than the rest of the test. The dishonesty here, that is apparent at least, is willful ignorance. But there's also a chance that Sean did know about these things and is just consciously lying. He certainly didn't care enough to check on something that's going to go into a video that he knows is going to get at least around 200,000 views. In addition, a focus and fixation on the bell curve itself is dishonest. His video is clearly about denying divergent evolution in humans. Ceteris paribus, there's no reason one should have any position on this matter in one direction or another, in the absence of evidence. If we were to argue environmental determinism for these gaps, he would have to make real arguments. He throws out school quality. Okay, what do the voucher studies show? He throws out poverty. Okay, what do the randomized income increase studies show? What do the adoption studies show? Etc., etc. But that's hard. It's much easier to critique, to needle the bell curve, and in this case, needle it in dishonest ways, than it is to present a case and argue what he is trying to argue, which is that evolution stopped at the neck. Fixating on the bell curve is already a straw man of hereditarianism. The arguments have long advanced since it was written, which Murray himself will attest. Sean then strawmans the bell curve, deliberately lying in several instances, and thus has erected a straw man of a straw man, and from doing this creates the impression that he has refuted the concept of divergent evolution in humans. And so even if everything Sean said in his video was correct, which it's not, the whole undertaking that he is doing is a sort of ideological shell game. You will hear his acolytes say that Sean focuses on the bell curve because so many Nazi or fascist or white supremacists, or whatever the term de jure is, that their, or I guess they would say my, arguments come from the bell curve. This is, of course, factually untrue. Very few studies I cite even so much as predate the bell curve, and those that do may or may not have even been in the bell curve. But then you see, wait a minute, if you're arguing against the bell curve because you wrongly think it's a font of hereditarian arguments, then what you're really saying is that you are opposed to hereditarianism, and you're merely attacking the bell curve as a way to get at hereditarianism, which is to say, my accusation that you're erecting the bell curve as an effigy, lighting it on fire, and then claiming to have refuted divergent evolution in humans, that my accusation is valid. And you know that this is exactly what you are doing.